Bonjour, Le Web. All week I've been dropping hints about the identity of our mystery cameraman. What do you think of that shot? Oh, he likes it. Oh, our mystery cameraman. He's a bit hostile. What do you think of that shot? Oh, our mystery cameraman. Beware his wrath. I can now reveal that it is none other than Eli Roth.
I wouldn't say I've been your bitch. I was helping you out. But it's been fun, you know? It's good because you got to be my bitch on set. So I figured, you know, I'd pay you back. And it's good because I think that'll be probably in prison after Hostel Part 2 is released. And I'm going to need a new job. So I'm sure I'd be somebody's bitch in prison. So this is a good start.
Well, there's no such thing as a dull day at the Cannes Film Festival, and today was no exception. First of all, we went to the Martini Terrazza to interview the shy and retiring Eli Roth.
I actually was an exchange student in a town called Grasse, which is about 20 minutes from here, and that was when I was 17 years old, and I came and visited Cannes and went to the Palais, and it wasn't the festival, but I always dreamed of coming back. And then I came back in 2000 when Mulholland Drive was here, and I got to go to the premiere of Mulholland Drive and watch David win Best Director, and I was going to the market with cabin fever and my investor packages, and I brought like 20 scripts and I ran around taking meetings, trying to hustle, which led to absolutely nothing. Every single person passed on it. I went back to America broke and empty-handed, but it was fun and I got to learn about how the film market worked. And so now to come back here and get to do press and actually be on the red carpet as an actor in a Quentin Tarantino film and as a director is pretty unbelievable. No. They're nice people. And the thing is, a lot of those people who turned me down are like, we're sorry, and now they're at other companies. So you can't ever say that to anyone because you never know where they're going to wind up. Success is the best fuck you of it all. You know, success, genuinely, it's like there's an inherent fuck you in success. You go, oh, no, it's too bad it didn't work out. Oh, it would have been great. That's like, there's just like a subtle fuck you laid in there.
Well, we're in the home stretch now. The Palme d'Or gets announced this weekend. And because I've been busting my buns for this diary all week long, in an up-at-dawn, pride-swallowing siege I will never fully tell you about, I've seen only two films. No Country for Old Men, which is a masterpiece, and Ocean's 13, which is, well, you'll read my review next week. It's online. And so because I don't know what I'm talking about, we've come here to the Grand Hotel to find some people who do.
I always think, in Cannes, the most memorable occasions have always been the terrible movies. Brand Bunny, the year of Brand Bunny, the year of Richard Kelly's Southland Tales, and I don't think there's been anything quite as...
It was rubbery.
The very dry answer is it's kind of the Attack of the Romanians, because, you know, in competition there's a tremendous Romanian film about abortion, which is going to be such a tough sell for the wider world, but it's great. The pretty boring answer is Angelina Jolie showed up, and yeah, what more do you need?
It's going to be remembered for a battle between the Americans and the rest of the world, and it's the best slate of American independent movies I've ever seen in Cannes in 10 years, but you need to have a really impressive rest of the world in order to make everyone look good, and I think this year's been fantastic.
It's been a white knuckle roller coaster rampage. Oh, I can't think of any of
you. The most surreal moment of Cannes for me is this film called World Peace. Mm-hmm. It's actually, imagine a 12-minute pop video. Mm-hmm. It's a cross between a Benetton advert and a Michael Jackson promo. It's made by this Iranian billionaire who wants to be Cliff Richard. You've got to track this film down on YouTube. Yeah. Believe me, you will not believe your eyes.
This is so girly, and I always try not to be a girly critic, but I got to a party. I went to the TCM party, and in the TCM party they have glass boxes full of bling. I put them on and I started hyperventilating and thinking, how can I get past these heavy men who are just standing around blocking me and dive over the side of the into the sea and swim off and keep... Yeah. I'm like Gollum.
My favourite person ever has to be, I guess, the Palme d'Or, which is probably the most stupid and frivolous and thoroughly irritating award that Cannes has ever hosted. And it's sort of where the British critics get their revenge on the art house side of the festival. The winner of the Palme d'Or award this year was actually the first time ever. It was a tie between a Thai movie and Persepolis, one of the official competition films. And, you know, the Thais were so... They gave the most sincere speech I've ever heard in my life because their film is about stray dogs. And everyone, you know, there's a tear in my eye. And, you know, the whole point of this thing is it's meant to sort of serve to stick a finger up. But, you know, they took it seriously. And actually it made the Palme d'Or and made one of my favourite moments in Cannes this year.
I really like Import-Export, okay. The ultra-depressing Austrian movie that also included the Ukrainian internet porn sex workers and all kinds of grim depressiveness, but I don't really think that stands much of a chance.
Probably the Romanian film, 4 months, 3 weeks and 2 days. I don't think it will, because you know, every time you guess, you get it wrong.
Most outstanding film, according to, by consensus of the critics here, is a Romanian film about a Romanian film about an abortionist, which apparently is Vera Drake, but without the endless cups of tea.
I think probably the Diving Bell and the Butterfly's got a good chance. And the Romanian abortion movie.
The film with the best chance of winning the Palme d'Or this year would have to be The Magnificent IRA Zombies. After all, it's the only film in the competition that has a sheep with a gun in it. Apart, of course, from Wong Kar-wai's Sheep with a Gun.
At the end of the night, I had a chat with Chris Doyle, and I remember saying to him, frankly, I'd rather be a wanker than a c***. And he said yes, and I agree with you, but I can't remember why.